Hello, my name is Obishagun Maye. I want to specially welcome you to Post 104 class. The course still remains Introduction to World Politics, or per se, World Politics in View. A course that tries to expose you to the knowledge of politics at global stage. Being a political being, you should know that states also participate in politics. States are also political beings, they are also political entities. Now, let's look at what we have discussed briefly. In our last few classes, we have looked at third world. We looked at third world. What is third world? What are the characteristics of third world? What are the nations that make up the world that is given the position of third? And what kept them in that position? How did they arrive at that position? And in our discussion, we did mention the fact that Africa is the most represented continent in the League of Third World Countries. So today we will be looking at the African Union. The African Union, we're taking the politics down to the continent of Africa. We want to look at the African Union. In 1961, the non-aligned movement was formed, and one of the lessons that Africa as a continent was able to learn from that movement, it was the peak of the Cold War era. I believe we have discussed Cold War in this class. It was the peak of the Cold War era, and one of the things that the Cold War, the non-aligned movement, the movement whereby a group of countries came together to pledge their neutrality in the war, the ideological war between the Eastern Bloc led by Russia and the Western Bloc led by the United States of America. By 1963, the continent of Africa had been able to organize itself into forming what was referred to as the Organization of African Unity. This organization was the continental body that pursued the interests of Africa and Africans after and within that period. So from 1963 to 2002, the OAU was the body that collectively fought for the interest of Africa. Part of the objectives of the OAU, or part of the reasons for the formation of OAU, was to fight for the freedom of colonized territories in Africa. So, as at that time, colonialism was in vogue, and the colonial masters became the common enemies of Africa and Africans. So, OAU was able to a reasonable extent fight the war against colonialism. It was able to gain independence for most of the colonized territories within the continent of Africa. It was able to defend African interests. It was able to push for the respect of Africa within the Committee of Nations in the world. However, it dawned on certain African leaders from 1999, to be specific. Muammar Gaddafi of blessed memory, the then leader of Libya, was pushing for a more united Africa, a more united continent of Africa that is beyond unity, that will take its unity to a union, that will push its then level of unity to an integrated region of the world, that will make OAU to transform to a union just as we have it in the United States of America. In fact, Gaddafi was clamoring for the creation, the formation, or the transformation per se of OAU from a unity to a state where you have 55 countries as we have it now becoming either a federation or a confederation with a president and giving respect for the component unit just as we have it in the United States of America. This could not be achieved from 1999 with the instrumentality of Thabo Mbeki of South Africa, Chief Olusegun Obasanjo of Nigeria, and Muammar Gaddafi of Libya in 2002 at the SATE conference. The birth of a new African regional body was announced. And that body is what we call the African Union. Officially, it came into being in 2002, even though the treaty to form this body was signed in 2001 at the Lome Accord, but it officially came into being in 2002. And the headquarters of it still remain in Addis Ababa, Ethiopia. The first president of the union was Mr. Thabo Mbeki, the then president of South Africa. What is the composition of OAU? The OAU is made up of the former members of OAU, which are independent countries in Africa. Today, as of today, we have 55 of them who are registered members of the Union. What are the reasons for the formation of AU? Having seen the fact that the main reason for the formation of OAU, as I said, was to fight the common enemy of the continent of Africa, which at that time was colonialism. Now, most territories in Africa we have been freed, which all thanks to the OAU. But African problems still persist. These problems of identity in Africa still persist. The challenges facing the continent of Africa, where you had the problem of poverty, underdevelopment, unemployment, diseases, and people living in squalor, people finding it hard to feed, hunger and starvation characterizing the continent of Africa, division, lack of unity that OAU preached. There was no unity because people were still divided along religion, along ethnic and up tribal, along what the Itato colonial masters gave to them. We still have Francophone, we still have Anglophone, we still have the Arab world, we still have them in their various divisions, which was not helping the continent. It was in this foresight that Muammar Gaddafi pushed for the formation of first the United States of Africa, USA too, which to him would be able to give America the challenge that she needs, because America as a continent is not as big as Africa as a continent. Africa today still remains the second largest continent after Asia. So if, in the view of the founders of the Union, Africa could be united as one political entity, then the problems of Africa that I've mentioned before will be collectively addressed and battled easily won. When the resources are put together, they will be able to press for a swifter development. So the reasons, one, was to get a more integrated continent of Africa. That after the unity, so to say, then what we talk about in the world today is integration. Just like the European Union, Africa is to be knitted, where you have a common currency, a central bank to manage the fiscal policy of the continent. You have a uniform language, a common language. Africa was to adopt a uniform language, who have their own lingua franca to be picked from the indigenous languages within the continent, so as to have a more integrated continent. Integration will go beyond every other means. We have a borderless relationship, although the sovereignty of the continent will be respected, or the countries who will have been the component unit if we are to achieve what Gaddafi was envisaging, a United States, just like an America, where we have a federation of 55 countries coming together to form one giant country called United States of America, of Africa, is to help to fight the challenges, the common enemies of Africa. The common enemies of Africa are transformed from colonialism that OAU fought to neocolonialism and the current trend of globalization, which is fast stealing or robbing the continent of her cultural values and identities. The AU is to help the continent to fight the common enemies so as to help to achieve a more knitted, a more united body of black people in the world, because Africa houses the largest population of blacks in the world. So the AU is to help achieve that, is to help have a uniform political system where democracy in Africa formation, in Africa color, will be in vogue, will be the major practice. Democracy of Africa description, not the ones that have been imposed by the West, led by America. The African democracy which has the human value or the human face to protect, will be fully entrenched in all parts of Africa. This will help in the political development of the continent, according to the proponents of AU. It is also to help protect the interest of the people of Africa in the community of other nations in the world, in the community of nations in the world, so that Africa will be able to speak in one accord. Africa will be able to pursue one interest, say, when they are in the United States, in the United Nations. When Africa go to the United Nations organization, the AU is to help Africa pursue one agenda and make sure that Africa realizes its own agenda. It is also one of the reasons for the formation of AU, to help get better bargain for the continent of Africa, especially in the Security Council of the organization of the United Nations, that Africa will have a better share of the bargain. As a continent, Africa has no single representative in the permanent council, in the permanent members of the Security Council of the United Nations, having been remaining the largest continent in the world, Africa still has no single member in the Security Council of the United Nations, of which almost all the members, the 54 members of Africa of the AU, are members of the United Nations. It is to help fight all forms of discrimination again in Africa, all forms of discrimination in Africa and of Africa outside Africa, all forms of discrimination in Africa and of Africa within and outside the continent of Africa. It is in the interest of the AU to wage war against such ills that have been meted to Africa and Africans. Having said this, the AU have been able to, in its own way, achieve some feats. In fact, may I let you know that in 2011, the Southern Sudan was added to AU membership because it remained the last country to gain independence in the continent of Africa, and all thanks to the effort put in place by the Union for the freedom of every part of the continent that is still under one form of domination or the other. It has been able to expand the political scope within the continent. It has been able to engage in more formidable peacekeeping missions within the continent. And even outside the continent, the African Union has been able to help maintain peace and security within Africa, in Southern Sudan, in Congo, in Liberia, and all the places where we've had unrest. Even in Libya and Egypt, including Tunisia, AU have been on the forefront in fighting for peace and unity and of the continent. It has been able to help in fighting diseases, in fighting the common enemy, pushing for the eradication of diseases. You know, for some times now, the continent has been ravaged by a disease called Ebola, where a lot, thousands of Africans have been killed by the disease. African Union have been, in one way or the other, helping the countries that have suffered from this disease called Ebola and every other disease. It has been able to expand the scope of relationship with Africa. It has been able to expand the scope of relationship in Africa, pushing for a common passport, a common custom union like we have it in the sub-regional groups like ECOWAS. The AU is also pushing for a common passport that will help in the movement of goods and services, the movement of free movement of labor within the continent of Africa. What are some of the challenges that AU is still facing? Just like the OAU, the AU is also facing its own challenges, which include one, the influence of the former colonial master. Africa, I told you before, is still divided among the language lines, especially the lingua franca imposed on the continent by the colonial masters. So this also is still ravaging the continent, because in the AU today, you have the official languages to be Arabic, English, French, Portuguese. All these are not natives in Africa. They are not native languages of Africa. So the inability of the Union to come up with a single language that is native to Africa is a serious challenge, because the adopting the foreign languages that are imposed on them as official still means that AU, just like the OAU, is still tied to the apron string of the former colonial masters. Two, the problem of poverty. Most of the dreams that AU intend to achieve requires huge sums of money, of which most members of AU still suffer from the scourge of poverty at its peak now. Poverty in Africa is even at climax. In addition, the general underdevelopment of Africa still poses a threat to the survival of a union. You want a union of poor people, of almost underdeveloped countries coming together to solve their problem. They will be looking outside for their survival. So the problems of underdevelopment facing the continent is also a threat to, or a challenge to, the AU achieving its aims and objectives. Another serious problem, or another serious challenge that AU is facing today is that of political instability. A union that wants to push for democracy. In fact, the founder, one of the chief proponents of AU, in person of Muammar Gaddafi, was forced out as a military general. He was forced out of office, although the ripple effect is still being felt, thereby having unquenchable crisis in Libya as till date. What are the problem of terrorism? The rising space of terrorism and insecurity in the continent of Africa is a challenge to the AU today. Almost every part of Africa is suffering from what we call terrorism, especially the western part of Africa, where ISIS have even declared its own territory, Islamic State of West Africa, with Boko Haram, Al-Qaeda, Al-Shabaab, and all the terrorist groups waging war against the peace and stability of the continent. With this and many more, you know that AU is trying to achieve its dream of having a union, a more integrated continent of Africa. However, it is still a high hill task for the continent to remain one undivided and developed continent. Until I see you next in our next session, I want you to go into full exploration of how AU have been able to impact a country like Nigeria, probably using the instrumentality of the agencies like NEPAD and Africa Peer Review Mechanism. Thank you very much.